For many people, buying a home is the American dream come true. So what would you do if criminals turned your dream into a nightmare, buying, selling, and using illegal drugs right in front of your house? And more research suggests that drug and alcohol abuse can be symptoms of an underlying mental illness. Is Pierce County doing enough to identify and treat those who suffer from behavioral health issues? We'll answer those questions and more right now on Pierce County Talks. Welcome to Pierce County Talks. I'm Erich Ebel. At an August 2015 meeting of the Pierce County Council, one man took advantage of the Citizens Forum portion to draw attention to the epidemic he says is destroying his neighborhood. Ted Hartman is an average Pierce County resident. He goes to work, pays his taxes, but his story appeared to catch the council by surprise.
Is there anyone else? Yep, come on up.
After each council meeting, the public is always invited to raise any issues they'd like. Ted Hartman brought his.
In the past 2 years, we've been overran by meth and heroin dealers. Buyers coming in as we were leaving our house today, trying to hide from us. Drug users, homeless people coming in and out all hours of the day and night. Felons with guns, thieves, break-ins, cars racing in and out, people sleeping in cars, people sleeping under trees, dumping their garbage, cars and foot traffic coming in, staying no more than a few minutes.
Hartman detailed the issues he's had when he's tried to confront the problem himself.
If we approach them about it, we're told to mind our own business. We're met with profanity, obscene gestures, harassed, threatened to be taken care of, property vandalized, garbage thrown in front of our gate, a gas can thrown on our property the day after the fire department was called for them burning their garbage. Was it a message? They tell us in plain and simple terms, if we don't like it, they'll just do it more.
And Hartman told the council what happened to his previously blue-collar neighborhood.
Because your property values are so negatively affected, if you want to leave, your only option is to simply walk away from everything you worked for, like more than one neighbor has done.
Perhaps most importantly, Hartman underscored his need for assistance.
We need help. This cannot continue. We no longer feel safe in our home or on our property, so I'm asking for your help.
Joining me now to talk more about drug use in neighborhoods around Pierce County is Ted Hartman, along with Pierce County Councilmember Jim McCune, who chairs the Public Safety and Human Services Committee. Welcome to you both.
Thank you for having us.
So tell me, Ted, you recently addressed the council, as we saw. How did you feel while you were there telling the council about
the issue? Not the greatest public speaker, but it had reached a point where we really feel it needed to be addressed higher up the ladder. It's just gotten so out of control over there in the last 2 years that we're just out of options, don't know where else to turn, and got the option to come in there. And
can you tell us some of the stories that you were relating to the council about the activity that goes on in your neighborhood?
It's several things. They're all combined. It's all the same people doing the same thing. It's homeless people that come in and sleep on your property. People that come in and tell you while you're on your property what you should be doing. Leave them alone. They're going to do whatever they want. Traffic, uncontrollable traffic, just in and out. Cars coming in for a couple minutes, leaving. People walking in, people on bicycles coming in to a couple different residences in the neighborhood. Same people, though. Going house to house.
And you've got a lot of this on camera.
We have security cameras. That's one of the things. This just blew up almost overnight. Some neighbors moved in just overnight. All of a sudden, we had people out in our driveway in the middle of the night, and you'd go out there to ask them, what are you doing? Mind your own business. And so we put up cameras. That was the first thing we did, put up cameras, and started seeing the activity that is going on 75 feet from where you're sleeping, and the cameras are capturing everything, drug deals, everything.
It's frightening. Councilmember McCune, the time that Ted testified, was that the first time you've heard about issues like this?
It's not the first time I heard of issues like this, but Ted brought it heavily to my attention. And so I went out to his site to view the site, and there's definitely a ton of drug activity. In fact, of the eight houses, after I talked to Ted, I got several other calls of drug houses, and his is definitely the most impact of the ones I visited.
Highest traffic?
Highest traffic. Leaf imbalance is a huge amount of traffic.
So when Ted brought that to the council's attention, how did the rest of the council react? It was sort of caught by surprise.
They might have been caught by surprise, but I'm a really hands-on council member. I like to go out on site, whether it's a land use or whatever. I go out on site, I want to see what's going on. I actually go out in the woods with them or whatever. And so it makes it a little different than me. Maybe other council members aren't so hands-on and go out right into the houses and beat track around and see what's going around the neighborhoods. So I want to protect my constituents, and we really want to eradicate the drugs out of our neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm. Ted, you mentioned that this has been going on for about 2 years now. Tell me some of the steps that you've taken to bring this to the attention of anybody who listens.
Well, initially it was to go out and approach the people, ask them what they're doing. Once we discovered what was going on, then it's when we started calling the sheriff, asking for help, getting the sheriff in there. It was an eye-opener when one night we got a call back from a deputy that he was well aware of the people, knew the names, knew that they had served a search warrant on one of the houses already. We didn't even know that. We were gone that weekend or something, but they were well aware of it. And their statements, they thought they had it shut down. And it just continued to grow. From there, it was trying to contact anybody we could, asking for help. We had an assistant at a gym's office contact, had me meet with a lady who had organized a very successful block watch program. And I was skeptical of it because the people you're watching are your neighbors. Mm-hmm. And so, but I agreed to meet with her, and Amy and this lady met, and when I laid it out, and I had a map, and I laid it out, and who was who, they just looked at each other and said, yeah, that won't work, because it's your neighbors you're watching.
Right.
We've tried talking to the property owners, to the landlords, and met with, not anger, but mind your own business. Hmm. These are my renters. Mm-hmm. Approached the people that actually do live in the house, you know, let them know that we know what's going on, and met with threats. And at that point, when the threats start and they're going to take care of you and going to take care of your dog and
right.
this and that, it's
scary.
That's when the letter started to the county commissioners.
So tell me, and I have to ask this because I think some of our viewers might be thinking it, at what point do you say enough is enough, we're going to pack up and move? This neighborhood's gone to pot, literally.
Yeah. There has been neighbors that have done that. One of the ladies, it's now a vacant house that's been destroyed by these people. There's needles in there. They broke all the pipes. They stole all the wiring. They destroyed this house, which at one time 28 years ago was the nicest house in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. This lady, senior citizen, had MS, and she would be out during the day. She would be out picking up the garbage that they had thrown on the road during the day. They actually broke into her house 3 times while she lived there. So she moved her son-in-law and daughter in with her. And in that, they kept breaking in. And she just gave up and left. And I suppose if we were smarter, we would have left before it got all taken care of, or before it all escalated to this point. But we don't want to be driven from our home either. That's where my wife and I have lived for 28 years. We raised our 2 children there. It's not an option to say these renters and these homeless people and these landlords that don't want to abide by law and code and zoning to drive law-abiding people out of the neighborhood. It's just not right.
So you brought this to the attention of Councilmember McCune and the other council members. Councilmember McCune has gone out to your house on a number of occasions and seen the activity for himself. So tell me, what can the county do now that we've identified the fact that there's a problem? What can the council do about it?
Well, besides law enforcement, I'm looking into other options, codes that possibly, especially on owners that are renting houses out, that we maybe come down on them for knowingly renting houses to drug dealers. So I'm looking at other jurisdictions and maybe out of state, what they have done in this area. I know there's some programs out there. Well, I got one out of Kent, but it doesn't seem to fit this application. So I'm working on that side I can work on. And law enforcement, I know they have their hands tied a lot, and there's a lot of activity going on, but we're looking at more funding for the sheriff. I'm talking with other council members now, see if we can get that funding for that task force they need for home burglary and robbery, and it would be drugs, whatever it would be for home. And so they take hire six officers, and that'd be a new task force. Their main focus would be on this issue, and then they would bring in new officers as well. And so we're hoping to get that funding for that task force. This isn't going to stop and go away. These guys are really abrasive. I mean, they come in, buy their drugs. They don't even look left or right. They're just
out in the open.
Yeah, they might as well be up on the main street and in a shopping center selling these drugs. Of course, you know, in drugs deal, they don't sell all the drugs there. They have runners. They have people bring the drugs in, and I think Ted here knows almost everything about these guys. He's got them all written down. What car does the running?
The schedule.
Everything.
Sure.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this: the council recently had a proposal before it, which addressed behavioral health issues.
Mm-hmm.
Now, behavioral health encompasses not only mental illness but also mm-hmm. drug use and drug abuse and other chemical dependency issues. Do you think that a proposal addressing behavioral health could help stem the tide of what Ted is experiencing?
I'm not sure that it would. This is a behavior that you just don't easily knock on a guy's door and say, here's a brochure, you need to get to rehab. That ain't happening. If anybody wants to do that, good luck. These guys are criminals. And if you talk to other criminals that have been in prison for a while, they said it takes a few years before they get settled down. They're big shots going in, and it takes a few years before their mind actually gets. They're going to get rehabilitated in a prison setting, but they know they're doing a criminal activity. Rehab is not just that it. Now, it might be for some, but Ted has mentioned the homeless people. Those are wannabe homeless, a lot of them. They live in the woods, they're getting welfare checks, and they got food stamps, so they're not really just homeless. They live in their tents sometimes in different, or breaking into an abandoned house or something, and that's what they want to do. It's their life, and they're shooting up heroin. And we're not talking about marijuana, we're talking about generally heroin, a drug of choice now,
mm-hmm.
and it's a lot of needles around.
So you've got some ideas for ordinances mm-hmm. and potential legislation that could hopefully do something about this.
Right.
And those will go before your Public Safety and Human Services Committee.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
So, Ted, last question I have. Do you think that bringing your concerns to the county council was the right thing to do?
Well, my preference would be for Jim and everybody in the county and the sheriff's department to have never heard my name. That would be my preference. But this is, in part, I believe, escalated to this point, because nobody has come forward. When we've gone to neighbors that we know are good neighbors, they go to work, they work hard, and ask them for help in calling, and that, they're not interested. They're not interested until they're breaking into their home, and that's just a fact. It's the way the life is now. And did it help come to the county commissioners? Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Very good. Well, that's all the time we have. Councilmember McCune, I want to thank you for joining us. And Ted, I wish you the best of luck with this issue.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Coming up next, many people believe that those suffering from mental illness turn to drugs and alcohol to cope. And a recent proposal by the county council intended to be the first step toward better treatment for those with behavioral health issues. But did it pass? We'll find out after the break.
Don't worry, 74 people were picked before me in the NFL draft.
To fight childhood obesity, United Way and the NFL are helping kids play at least 60 minutes a day.
Okay, time for the team obstacle course.
Yay!
What this place needs is more healthy kids. To get involved or donate, go to unitedway.org/play60.
Now I get it.
Now you can see Pierce County from your phone or tablet with the new PCTV mobile app. Pierce County and City Council meetings, the weekly Pierce County News.
On PCTV.
News magazine Rainier Country, the topical discussions of Pierce County Talks, and all of the special programs in between. Download the app today and see Pierce County from here. PCTV, Pierce County Television.
On August 25th, the Pierce County Council took up the issue of behavioral and mental health services, considering a proposal that would inventory the current system and identify where gaps exist. PCTV's Greg McClellan has a look at the discussion and the final vote.
43, excuse me.
3-4.
A resolution considered this week by the Pierce County Council would have directed the county's Performance Audit Committee to inventory the mental and behavioral health system countywide. Several years ago, the county opted to have the state oversee mental health services in Pierce County. Opponents questioned whether a study showing gaps in the system could lead to a new sales tax to pay for mental health services.
But today, what we're doing is we're funding a study simply to bolster an argument so that we can send it, or we can go ahead and pass a 0.1% sales tax.
How can we compel the state to meet its constitutional responsibilities, or for that matter, ask the voters to tax themselves additionally without first adequately identifying what the problem even is? We don't know.
The proposal failed on a vote of 4-3. However, proponents say they're committed to finding ways to address the issue.
Despite the measure's failure, its sponsors say they will not be deterred in their fight to curb the mental health crisis in Pierce County. Joining me now are those sponsors, Councilmember Connie Ladenburg, who represents the 4th District, and Councilmember Derek Young, who serves the people of District 7. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
So let's start first by setting the stage with the terms. We don't call it mental health issues anymore. Now we're calling it behavioral health issues. Can you tell me why?
Sure. Actually, it came from the legislature. There's an effort to integrate chemical dependency and mental illness into kind of one field, and now they have named it behavioral health. A lot of it has to do with the way it's funded and all of those kinds of things, but it is the terminology that we will be using from now on out. So that's kind of a little bit of the history in a nutshell.
Speaking of history, if you could sort of give me a background of what Pierce County used to do for behavioral health and why it's not taken anymore.
A number of years ago, the county was challenged on how it was receiving funds from the state. And the county executive at that time was John Ladenburg. He negotiated for years, 2 or 3 years with them to try to get them to reallocate the way they were funding us. The way they were doing it was a per capita, and that wasn't of people with behavioral health or mental health issues. It was total population. So a community like King County received a whole lot more money, even though they didn't necessarily have a lot more people that had these kinds of mental health issues. So negotiations, nothing happened. And he basically talked to the council at the time, said, I think we should do something and possibly pull out of the RSN, Regional Support Network. They had a kind of a blow up, what are you doing, John Ladenburg, kind of a thing. He said, form a committee, study it yourself, which they did. And 2 or 3 years later, that committee, made up of not government people, it was mostly stakeholders in the community that were in the field, and they came to the same conclusion. And so we got out of doing the RSN. The state took it over, did a RFP, Optum, which is a private entity, won that contract. And so they run our regional support network. So they're the umbrella, they're the administrative umbrella is what it is.
And I understand they've been doing a pretty good job so far.
Yeah, they have. You know, there's some people that are, you know, have some concerns about it, like anything.
Sure.
Same thing when we were in charge.
Sure.
Can't make everyone happy. But generally, I think they've done a good job. That's what I've heard from people in the community.
So, Derek, let's fast forward to a council meeting we just had where you, along with Councilmember Ladenburg, proposed that the county study the behavioral health system comprehensively here in Pierce County to find out where the gaps are and what else we can do and what we're not doing and how can we do better.
Mm-hmm.
And tell me a little bit about that.
So the basic idea behind it, and this actually came from Councilmember Ladenburg originally, is that, you know, we know there's a problem, and we know that the scale is fairly large, but we don't know exactly how that all impacts A, county services, or B, services to the public, but also where we could improve. So, you know, because there's so many different moving parts and there's so many different parties providing service, both in the private sector, nonprofit, you know, and even and still in county government, we need to do a better job of figuring out where all that is and find those gaps in the system so we can close them. So it's more of a matter of, we know there are holes. We just don't know how big they are and where exactly they are.
So anyone who's interested can go to PCTV's website and watch the council meeting in its entirety to hear all of the arguments for and against. Tell me, in your words, how the council meeting went.
I think we were real close to a compromise and finding a way to move it forward. Just obviously didn't get there. But in my eyes, you know, we still are debating a lot of the same old issues going back to those days when, you know, the arguments that this is a state responsibility. I think that's a fair thing to say. But the problem is that doesn't solve who's actually getting served. So, you know, from my eyes, you heard from, you know, mental health providers, judges, you know, our sheriff and other law enforcement. We've heard over the years from our jailers, you know, that this is a huge problem there. So all those folks showing up and saying, please do something. And then we just weren't quite able to get there. And basically because of some government logistics, I think we'll ultimately find a way to move forward and get the study done.
Do you think that there's any credence to the arguments that it's the state responsibility now and we should be lobbying the state instead of focusing our efforts and spending our own taxpayer dollars? Or is it more of a combination of efforts? What do you think?
If I could speak to that a little bit. That comes from the language that's in the Constitution, and there is constitutional language. You know, of course, we've heard a lot about the McCleary decision in regards to education and courts and all of that stuff right now. Also language, not quite as strong, but still language, that speaks to the provisions of the institutions that provide for, and there's a couple different populations that they speak to, one of them being the insane. That's back in the 1800s, that's the language that they used, and that's also how they provided services. You know, over the years, especially in the 60s and 70s, people came out of the institutions into the community. And at that point in time, you know, whose responsibility was it then? Was it the state's responsibility? There's some argument that, yes, there still is, it still should be. But there's also, on the other side, it's also the community, the local community's responsibility to take care of the people, too. So that's, you know, there's argument on both sides, and including on our council. Some people say it's solely the state's responsibility. Then those of us say that it's both of ours or all of our responsibility, all governments, state and local, cities, actually, and counties' responsibility.
So, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, you know, one thing I would add to that is it traditionally public health has been the role of counties, and that's both in the state and nationally. So that's where I see the intersection coming in, that we do have a role in this. But I would even argue the study's necessary, even if you do think it's entirely the state's obligation, for two reasons. One, I think we should be able to argue that they have been underfunding, just like on education. So if you want a McCleary for mental health, this is the way to do it. The second thing is that you know, the state's recently started to ramp up some of their spending. I think we need to be arguing for that Pierce County has a disparate impact. You know, we have Western State Hospital located here. We also have, you know, more affordable housing. There's a bunch of different conditions that mean that we basically have a bigger problem in our county than others our size, so that we should get more funding. Both of those arguments need to be made with some comprehensive analysis in hand.
Does that stem from the fact that Pierce County for a very long time was sort of a dumping ground for criminals and the mentally ill who all then get out of prison or jail and end up in the community where...
There's a lot of evidence to that happening, you know, from our prison system and now from the hospital. Oftentimes someone goes into a prison or a hospital, their family follows them to that community and they stay here. When they're released, they're here. So it has had historic impacts to Pierce County, and we have not gotten compensated by the state because of that. you know, so it does impact our budgets and our community services, our social services. So not just governments, but everyone out in our community has kind of an overwhelming effect that is very difficult to address.
Is anything being done to sort of lobby the state for compensation right now?
Yes, and has been going on for a number of years, not only for compensation, but also for change in laws. And we've seen some success in that area. The Fair Share Bill a number of years ago, especially in regards to criminal justice situations, you know, where people have to go back to their county of origin. We're talking about doing the same kind of thing, you know, with other kinds of, you know, like the mentally ill and things like that, too.
You know, I think the our biggest obstacle, honestly, and we hear this from our own delegation and from legislators from other counties, is that we haven't passed the 0.1% sales tax for local mental health care. And that's something 22 other counties have done. So the vast majority of the larger counties, in fact, all large urban counties have passed it. So we sort of lose some ground. We hear it a lot from them, is that you take care of your own part first and then we'll talk. So we have that bit of an obstacle here in Pierce County as a result.
So the resolution yesterday failed. What is the next step to move this issue forward? It's not
pause,
a trick question.
Pause, hesitation. We're going to continue to work on it, you know, work together. You know, Rick Talbert was also very supportive of this and voted along with us, too. That needs to be said. Derek mentioned earlier, we were close yesterday. There has been a lot of movement, actually. When I first started talking about this well over a year ago, there was just like, you know, just people would get glazed looks, you know, like there's no way. And now at least they're listening, they're receptive, they're having some dialogue about it. So we've made some gains over that period of time. It's been very helpful having Derek on board the council and bringing his passion for this issue with him. You know, so I'm hopeful, a little hesitant in my hopefulness, but I am hopeful that, you know, we can accomplish this hopefully by the end of the year, that we can see some real strong movement.
Do you think that inroads can be made with your fellow council members?
Yeah, absolutely. I think they've shown an increased willingness to look at this, and it's a matter of making sure we get it done the right way. And I'll be the Pollyanna. I actually think it's coming, and it's going to be coming soon. And so whether it takes the form of going directly through the Performance Audit Committee or the council itself, one way or another, I think we're going to wrap this up.
Very good. Well, I appreciate both of you for being on the show today. That's all the time we have. Thank you
Thank
for joining
you.
Us.
Thank Thanks you. For having us.
You can watch this program online anytime or on our mobile app, available at PierceCountyTV.org. I'm Erich Ebel. Thanks for watching.